I hope everybody's doing all right. I want to tell you, I don't mean to be different and disappoint you if it makes you feel funny, because I want to be different, but happy Resurrection Day. Amen. Hallelujah. He is alive. Amen. And I, like I said before, before we got started, before some of y'all were here, I know he's alive. This may not mean a whole lot to you. You might be saying, man, that's proof of nothing. But I know he's alive because he lives inside of my heart. Amen. And he's brought life to me. Praise God. If you knew me before, you would have thought for sure that I was dead. But the Lord has given me life. Amen. I titled this morning's message, Hope for a New Life. It might be a little bit of a different kind of resurrection message than what you might have expected, but most of my messages are a little bit different than what people probably expect. But, you know, we got some people here this morning that maybe, I don't know, this might be the only time I ever get to talk to you. And then again, maybe I'll only get to talk to you a few more times. Who knows? The Lord might be coming back real soon. I hope we're all ready. Amen. But before we get started, I just want to kind of give you a little bit of context of where we are. And sometimes I'll do like a chronology on the board to kind of give people familiarized. Because, see, we believe at this church that the Bible is the inspired word of God. The word Amen. Inspired means theonoustos, God breathed. That God, it's not written by men. That's what the liberal scholars will tell you. That's what the History Channel will tell you. But we're here to tell you that God wrote the Word of God. How did he do that? Because he breathed his Word. Theonoustos, breathe. He breathed this Word into man and through man. He used man as a vessel to hold a pen, to write his Word on a papyrus, a piece of paper. Why? So that you one day, so that I one day could read the Word of the living God, that he would tell a story to explain to humanity that while they're in a predicament, a condition, a fallen state, he has a plan of hope and salvation and resurrection from the dead, that they could have life and life anew. That's yes. the message Amen. Of God. That's the message that he's sending to humanity. Amen. And I hope that this morning that the Holy Spirit will ignite the words that are spoken and make them real to your heart, because I've said it before, I can get up here and I can get real excited, and I can even have, sometimes veins will pop out of my forehead, but none of that's going to change anybody's heart. The Holy Spirit revealing the Word of the living God to your heart will bring change. Yes, amen. Amen. But because we believe that the Word is inspired, given by God to teach us His ways, we need to know what it is that we're talking about. We don't shrink back from teaching the Bible. We teach the Bible. Amen.
That's right.
And so what I usually start off with in the chronology is the fall of man. Because, see, I'm trying to tell you the story of the gospel. The word gospel literally, and we'll talk about it at some point, it means good news. But what we need to understand is that in order for us to be receptive of good news, we need to understand why we need good news is because there's some bad news. The bad news is that all of mankind born of Adam is born into a fallen state. Yeah. See, that's why you see divorce rates rampant. And listen to me, I've experienced divorce. That's why you see drugs and alcohol rampant in people's lives, destroying people's lives, causing horrible things to take place. I've experienced some of that personally in my own life, in some ways in very traumatic instances. That's why you see crime rates and all these various things. And that's why the Bible talks so much about sin. And sometimes people wonder, why does that preacher preach so much about sin? Because sin is the root cause of all of the problems that we experience. Even sometimes things that we're experiencing emotionally and things that we're experiencing that we don't even really know what the root cause is, I'm here to tell you, many times it's because of the root of sin. And so God's got a plan. He's got a plan for sin. And so the fall of Adam or the fall of man, immediately, you know, I got to be careful. I don't go off too much. But we know that the act of sin that originally caused sin to come into Adam. And what I do want to make a point from this is that according to the Word of God, the entirety of the human race comes from the loins of Adam. Every human being that ever walked the face of the earth comes from Adam, inherited from Adam, some unsavory, I've said it before, DNA. The problem, like psychology says, isn't because of your daddy. The problem with psychology is because of your daddy's 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 daddy. His name was Adam, and it was because of sin that comes down the human race. But the good news is that there was one man that walked upon the earth that wasn't from the seed of Adam. His name was Jesus.
Amen.
God's whole plan, his whole gospel message is coming forth from the beginning to the end to tell us the story of how he was bringing Jesus into this fallen earth. The Word of God is in unity. The Old Testament, the New Testament alike are in unity with one another. You read behind some scholars, they would tell you that there's no unity. It's only disunity. That's a lie. There's one story, and he's telling us the story of salvation. Amen. Even in the fall, right after the fall, man would try to cover himself with fig leaves, but God killed an animal, a sacrifice, an innocent sacrifice, shed its blood and covered Adam and Eve with the skins of an animal, showing them that it would require death to pay the payment for sin that would result in life. So after the fall, though, the next big thing on the stage is the flood, right? We hear the story. Mankind has fallen into sin. And, you know, hey, if you can only imagine, the times of the flood were worse than the times are today, as hard as that is for us to wrap our minds around. But it was so bad that God destroyed the world with a flood. And the next big scene on the story is the Tower of Babel. I've done independent research. I've shared this with the church before. That many linguists who study languages have actually, scientists who don't even believe in God, atheists, believe that all the languages came from one original language. And I have to tell you that that's the Bible story. The Bible story is that all of mankind was of one language, and that they came together. They were supposed to remultiply, scatter over the face of the earth, because, see, in the end, the book of Revelation says that we would be priests and kings from all nations all over the world. God's plan was that this earth would be repopulated with mankind, and that his story would be told, and that ultimately, not just the Jewish people, but that all people from all over the world would have an opportunity at salvation. Well, they came together under the leadership of a man named Nimrod. Interestingly enough, much of our modern day celebrations that center around the word Easter come from this original time frame of Babylonian mystery religion. We're not going to get into that too much. I'll probably mention it in a little bit, but I don't want to spend too much time on that. But God confused their languages because, see, they refused to do what God wanted them to do. They came together under the leadership of Nimrod. And what God did was he confused their languages according to the tribes, according to the family groups of Noah's family, and caused them to spread over the earth. And now there were different nations that were developed from that. But if you turn the page, there's a man named Abraham in the next chapter. And what God told Abraham was, he told him, hey, you know, one of the things that was interesting to me whenever the whole first desert storm thing went down, because I was kind of a novice to some extent of studying the Bible, but I was just kind of really getting into it. I mean, even though I'd been a Christian for quite some time. And after the desert storm thing went down in Iraq, some people raided an ancient museum that had ancient artifacts. And one of the things that they spoke about on the news was articles from the pre-Abrahamic period were taken. And I was just blown away whenever I saw that, because it was kind of like secular news was acknowledging the fact that there was an Abraham and that there was a pre-Abrahamic period that had existed, and that there were artifacts within this museum that were taken and destroyed, right? So I don't know if that means anything to you, but it means a lot to me. Because it tells me that there was a man named Abraham. And the Bible gives testimony of the fact that this man Abraham was called by God out of a place called Ur of the Chaldees. You know, I draw this map for y'all all the time, that this is the Sea of Galilee, the Dead Sea, the Jordan River. This is Israel in between the two. And then there are two rivers over here, the Tigris and the Euphrates. And God called Abraham from this place right here, from ancient Babylon, and he said, I'm going to make a nation out of you. Now, the cool thing about that is that you can still turn on the television today and you can see on CNN all of this stuff going on in the Middle East, and that there's actually a nation called Israel. God called a man named Abraham out of Ur of the Chaldees. From Abraham, he had a son named Isaac. Isaac had two sons. One was named Jacob. Jacob had 12 sons. Jacob's name was changed to Israel. Those 12 sons became the 12 tribes of Israel, which ultimately became the nation of Israel in the nation of Egypt as they were slaves. So the next big step is the Passover, when God brought Israel out from Egypt through the Red Sea. Amen? He delivered them out through on the Passover night. I've told the story many times to the people in the church. They're probably, hopefully, not bored with it, but very familiar with it. That on that night, and what's interesting is that thousands of years later, Jesus would be crucified on that very night, on the Passover night. On that night in Egypt, God told Moses to take a lamb that had no blemish, that was representative of the fact that he was without sin, to take that lamb and to cut its throat, to collect its blood, and to paint blood on the doorpost and the side post. He said, and it was pretty cool because if you look at it, you painted it here and here and here, and it actually makes the sign of the cross. I don't know, you know, if it was just coincidental, but interesting nonetheless. And what God told him was that when I see the blood, I will pass over you. He said, you have to be in the house and you have to eat the lamb and it has to be roasted by fire. Fire represents judgment. The lamb represents the sacrifice. Again, an innocent sacrifice dying in place of the guilty. When I see the blood, I will pass over you. Egypt represents the world. Pharaoh represents the devil. You and I, like slaves, like Israel, we're slaves to Egypt. We're slaves in the world, born of Adam the first time. But hallelujah, God promised that he would send a lamb. Yes. Paul the apostle, thousands of years later, said that Jesus was the Passover lamb. And God brought those people out of Egypt on that Passover night whenever the death angel came through and killed the firstborn of everything that was there. And he delivered his people through on dry ground. Amen. But they wandered in the wilderness for 40 years. Finally, he brought them into the land known as Canaan, the promised land. Now we know it as Israel. And we know that there was a time frame afterwards. Well, first there was a time frame of the judges. And then God, through Joshua, brought them into the promised land. And then after that, there's a time frame known as the king. That's where we are. First and Second Kings. We're going to preach out of First. We're going to preach out of Second Kings today. The kings tell a story of in the beginning of Israel's monarchy, whenever they had king. There was a time when they didn't have a king. And they cried that they wanted a king, and God gave them King Saul. And then we know that after that, they received David as their king, who was God's choice to begin with. We're going to be reading out of 2 Kings chapter 5, by the way. And then after King David, his son Solomon took the throne. And many of you are aware of the fact that Solomon practiced some of these old Babylonian rituals, Canaanite rituals. How? Because his wives that he married himself to drew his heart away from the things of God. God warned his people, if you connect yourself to the people of the world, they're going to draw your hearts away from me. And that's what Solomon did. He connected his heart to the people of the world, to the women of the world. He married many of these women, and they talked him into making altars for their gods. God was very grieved with Solomon's decision, and the kingdom was split in two. The book of the Kings, 1 and 2 Kings, tell a story of king after king after king after king in both the northern part of the kingdom and the southern part of the kingdom, worshiping false gods and going the way of the world. It also tells a story of how God would send prophets that would perform miracles, that would preach the truth about God, and would warn the people that they were going in the wrong direction, and that God wanted them to return to him. And so that's where we are in this context of the story that we're speaking this morning. It might seem a little bit like a strange passage of scripture to preach for a resurrection, but to me it makes perfect sense. And once again, the title is Hope for a New Life, 2 Kings chapter 5. We're actually going to go ahead and read the whole chapter. It says, now Naaman, captain of the host of the king of Syria, was a great man with his master and honorable, because by him the Lord had given deliverance unto Syria. Now, you got to get an understanding of what's going on here. First of all, Syria is the enemy of God's people, Israel. But yet at the same time, the Bible says that God gave favor to Naaman, this general in the Syrian army. You know, we see on the news all this stuff about Syria right now. This is the same Syria that was in existence then that we see on the news today. Still the enemies of Israel. Nothing in that sense has changed. But God uses sometimes the enemies of his people in order to get his people's attention. And that was going on at this time frame also. And God had, basically what you need to see here is that Naaman, he was actually a general of an army, and he was very honorable. God had given him many victories and used him to bring deliverance to Syria. He was also a mighty man in valor, but he was a leper. And the Syrians had gone out by companies and had brought away captive out of the land of Israel a little maid, a little girl is what she was, and she waited on Naaman's wife. So she became a servant in Naaman's house. And she said unto her mistress, "Would God my Lord were with the prophet that is in Samaria." This is King James Version of the Bible. Basically what she's saying is, "Boy, I wish my Lord were with the prophet of Israel." And she said unto her, "Would God my Lord were with the prophet that is in Samaria." Samaria is the middle portion of Israel. "For he would recover him of his leprosy." And one went in and told his Lord, saying, "Thus and thus said the maid that is of the land of Israel." And the king of Syria said, go, and I will send a letter unto the king of Israel." And he departed and took with him 10 talents of silver and 6,000 pieces of gold and 10 changes of raiment, means clothing. And he brought the letter to the king of Israel, saying, "Now when this letter is come unto thee, behold, I have therewith sent Naaman, my servant, to thee, that thou mayest recover him of his leprosy." So the king of Syria is writing a letter to the king of Israel saying, "We heard that there's hope in your land that my servant would be able to be delivered of his leprosy." And it came to pass when the king of Israel had read the letter that he ripped his clothes. It means he just tore his clothes. That's what they used to do in Israel. When they get stressed out emotionally, whenever they would begin to grieve emotionally, they would rip their clothes, and it was a sign of great emotion. So, for lack of better words, in modern day vernacular, he was freaking out, he was stressing out, and he ripped his clothes off his back. It said, "Am I God to kill and to make alive, that this man doth send unto me to recover a man of his leprosy? Wherefore consider, I pray you, and see how he seeketh a quarrel against me." Now, just this isn't even part of my message, but I just want to point something out. This is the leader of the nation. He hears the news that there's hope in his country. Hope that a man would be able to be delivered of leprosy. His response to that is that he rips his clothes and he thinks that this guy in Syria is trying to pick a fight with him. But there's this little girl that's held captive in Naaman's house, and she's going around saying, "Oh, I wish my Lord could be in Samaria with the prophet of God, because the prophet of God would heal him of his leprosy." You see the difference right there. It's not part of my message, between faith and a lack of faith. The little girl believed in the God that could heal. The king of Israel had no faith and couldn't believe that God could do anything. And it was so when Elisha, the man of God, that's the prophet, had heard that the king of Israel had rent his clothes, that he sent to the king, saying, "Wherefore hast thou rent thy clothes? Let him come now to me, and he shall know that there is a prophet in Israel." So Naaman came with his horses and with his chariot and stood at the door of the house of Elisha. And Elisha sent a message unto him, saying, "Go and wash in Jordan 7 times, and thy flesh shall come again to thee, and thou shalt be clean." But Naaman was wroth and went away and said, "Behold, I thought he will surely come out to me and stand and call on the name of the Lord his God and strike his hand over the place." He just thought he was going to, "Oh, Lord, come down here and do something and bring healing to this leper." But that's not what he did. And so it says, "They call on the name of his Lord, strike his hand over the place and recover the leper. Are not Abana and Pharpar, rivers of Damascus, better than all the waters of Israel?" So essentially what's happening is that the prophet's telling them, if you want to be made whole, you got to go dip yourself in the Jordan River. Now, I can tell you that the Jordan River was considered very unclean, but the problem that Naaman is having is that the rivers of Syria, where he comes from, are a whole lot better than the river of Israel, and he's trying to think this whole thing through logically. And he goes on to say, "May I not wash in them and be clean?" So he turned and went away in a rage. And his servants came near and spoke unto him and said, "My father, if the prophet had bid thee do some great thing, wouldest thou not have done it? How much rather then when he saith to thee, wash and be clean? Then went he down and dipped himself 7 times in Jordan, according to the saying of the man of God. And his flesh came again like the flesh of a little child, and he was clean." I told y'all we were going to read the whole chapter, but I really just wanted to go to verse 14. The story of Naaman, like I said, might be seem a little strange to talk about resurrection, but there's several elements to this story that describe really the kind of resurrection that I want to talk to you about this morning. We could focus on the physical resurrection of Jesus, and many times that's what the messages this morning that are being preached focus on. They focus on the fact that there's an empty tomb, amen, and hallelujah, I got good news for you. The tomb is still empty. I probably say this every time I preach on Resurrection Day that, you know, about 10, 12 years ago, I was reading on some news article and they found they had Buddha's bones and they moved Buddha's bones from one location to another location. You won't ever hear them talk about moving Jesus's bones because they'll never find Jesus's bones. Amen. And don't think that they didn't try, because if you read the story, the Roman government hired people, or really the high priest had them hire people, soldiers, people to protect the tomb because they were concerned that somebody was going to steal the bones of Jesus. I got good news for you this morning. They won't find Jesus's bones. They won't be relocated because they're nowhere to be found, because once again, he rose from the dead, amen, and he's living on the inside of the hearts and lives of people that choose to believe the truth, amen. And so I'm not going to talk a whole lot about the physical resurrection this morning, but I do want you to know that he paid the complete payment of sin for every human being alive, and it's theirs. All they have to do is accept it by faith. The resurrection means a lot of things in reference to Jesus. If you go to Romans chapter 1, verse 4, in other words, what I mean is that it proves a lot of things about Jesus. It proves the fact that he had no sin. Why? Because if he had sin, he wouldn't have risen from the dead. It proves the fact that he paid for every single sin. Why? Because if he had not paid the penalty for every sin, then he would not have rose from the dead. But all of that is really expressed in this one verse of scripture, Romans 1:4. Jesus was declared to be the Son of God with power according to the Spirit of holiness by the resurrection from the dead. The power of the Spirit of God raised Jesus from the dead, and this proved he was the Son of God. Why? Because it proved he wasn't the son of Adam.
Right.
Like I told you in the beginning of the story, each and every man born of Adam has received from Adam. I called it unsavory DNA. The Bible calls it a sinful nature. We were born of Adam already under the curse of sin. Now, psychology may have a problem with that. One of my favorite preachers used to make the point, don't tell me that sin is a learned trait. Sin is something that we're born with. I can prove it to you. It's not very scientific, but it sure will work. Take two toddlers, 15 months, probably 12 months, maybe even younger than that. Put them in the same crib, give them one rubber ducky, and then back up and watch what's going to happen. You don't have to teach one child to take from the other child or for them to fight over something. They have a covetous desire for that rubber ducky, and they want it to be theirs, and they will fight tooth and nail to make sure that they get what it is that they're wanting to get. That's not how it has to be a learned behavior. As a matter of fact, you have to teach children to do the right thing and to share, right? Because it's inherent on the inside of us. So the resurrection proves that Jesus was the Son of God. It proves that he was holy, that he was altogether from another seed. He wasn't of the seed of Adam, because the Spirit of God rose him from the dead. We need to understand above all else that the same power is at our disposal. You need to know that this morning. You need to know that the same power that raised Jesus from the dead, but not just to physically raise us from the dead, but for God to exhibit his resurrection power in each and every one of us every day in our lives. Amen. Today, while we're still walking and breathing and living on this earth. You know, I don't call it Easter. I call it Resurrection Day. I used to call it Easter, even as a Christian, for a long time. I'm not trying to make you feel weird. I'm not over here trying to poke you in the eyeball. You call it what you want to call it. One day you might see it my way. One day you might. But I call it Resurrection Day, so happy Resurrection Day, amen. Yeah. I don't want to bore you with all the details about how Easter got its name from the goddess Ishtar, which comes from Babylonian culture. I don't want to bore you with all the details of how the eggs represent her reference to fertility, and how the rabbits describe fertility, and how all of that stuff comes back from those ancient pagan practices. Do I believe that if you bought your kid a chocolate bunny that you put... No, that's not what I believe. Do I believe if you did an Easter egg hunt that's what you... No, that's not what I believe. I know know better than that. It's the same thing that if you tell your kids Santa Claus, it doesn't mean that you're trying to diss Jesus on the day that we celebrate his birthday. But at the same time, I just want you to know that's where those practices come from. And I've made it clear, and I'll keep making it clear, you know, and hopefully you don't get too upset with me. But then again, if you do, that's okay too. That we're here to preach Jesus. Amen. And we're here to preach the fact that he resurrected from the dead. And we don't want nobody, especially the Easter Bunny, stealing his day, stealing his time. You know, look, the only thing that these two things had in common back in the day, whenever the church, well, even during the time frames of Israel, is that they occurred at the same time of the year. The Passover that we talked about in Egypt was a festival that the Jewish people celebrated each and every year. The Passover and the spring equinox, also known as the vernal equinox, took place both in the springtime. Equinox is just a time of the day. It happens in the spring and it happens in the autumn, where the day and the night are approximately equal in length. And pagan, according to pagan culture, they would worship their gods during this time. That's the only thing that they have in common. But yet the church developed or adopted much of those practices in the early days. Well, it is what it is, of the Catholic Church, adopted and pulled that stuff into what it was that it believed. But essentially, the reason that a lot of these things were utilized is because the springtime represents new life, right? The leaves on the trees turn green from the harsh death that winter's freezes caused. The birds begin to sing in the air. The flowers bloom. Everything around us begins to scream new life. I suppose eggs hatch and bring to the life of a little chicken, right? And rabbits, their gestation period is only 31 days. That means once the time they conceive, it only takes them 31 days to pop out a litter of rabbits. That's new life, and it happens pretty quick. So all that has to do with, but that's not the kind of life we're talking about this morning. Amen? We're talking about the life of Jesus, that he shares with us if we will believe the truth of the gospel. And that's why I think that the story of Naaman is a perfect resurrection message. Naaman was a Syrian general, like I've already told you. He was successful in all of his endeavors. The scripture even says that the Lord blessed what it was that he was doing. He undoubtedly was a man of prestige. He probably had everything that money could buy during those times. But there was one problem that he had. He had leprosy. He was plagued by a horrible infection that would slowly eat away at the skin. It would cause severe deformities. I've preached on leprosy before since we started the church. You know, we don't really see leprosy too much anymore because now modern science and medicine knows that it was caused by a particular type of bacteria. And we can cure it now. But during that time frame, they didn't know how to cure it, and it was contagious. If somebody gets it today, it's still contagious. The infection would eat away and ultimately cause deformities to the point where people would lose their fingers, they would lose their ears, portions of their nose. In order for them to walk around in society, they would have to cover their face and cover their body to prevent the infection from spreading. And many times I've preached on leprosy, actually a couple of times in the church, and those of you that have been here would remember, they'd have to walk around as they were covered up, and they'd have to walk on the other side of the street and try to stay away from the crowd, and they'd have to scream, "Unclean! Unclean!" And so they were social outcasts. They were separated from those that they loved. Only their closest people would be able to even want to be by them, and then still at a distance. Can you imagine, like, not ever really even feeling human touch? Being so distant away from it that you couldn't even feel it. So while leprosy was an external condition that showed visibly the uncleanness of a man like Naaman, sin is a condition of the heart, causing the man or woman to be unclean spiritually, internally. And we've all been touched by it in our first birth in Adam. While it's true that others around us oftentimes can't see the effects of this disease called sin, we all know too well that there have been times in our lives that we've been weighted down by the results of what it does to us internally. Just as the leper was separated from society, the condition of sin separates us from the presence of the Lord. If anybody, I know y'all know what I'm talking about. Many people even know, even as a Christian, that whenever sin is allowed back into your life, you feel a separation from the presence of the Lord. You get to the point where sometimes you don't even want to engage in the things of God. You don't even want to hear about the things of God. You don't want to be around the things of God. But I have good news.
Yes.
I have good news that there's hope today. There's hope for new life. There's hope for spiritual cleanness. Just as there was hope for Naaman in our story, and the hope for Naaman came when someone was willing to share the gospel with him. The gospel means good news, and there was a little maid who had been caught in one of the skirmishes between Syria and Israel, and Naaman had kept her for himself to serve at his house with his wife. The Bible records the fact that she would talk about her home Israel and the fact that there was a prophet there that could relieve her master Naaman of his leprous condition. If you go back to 2 Kings 5, 2 through 4, we'll look again at that passage of scripture. It says, "And the Syrians had gone out by companies and had brought away captive out of the land of Israel a little maid, and she waited on Naaman's wife. And she said unto her mistress, 'Would God my Lord were with the prophet that is in Samaria, for he would recover him of his leprosy.' And one went in and told his Lord, saying, 'Thus and thus said the maid that is of the land of Israel.'" How beautiful it would be if you and I would allow God to use us like this little girl, use us in a similar fashion where we could let others know that God has a plan to relieve them of their unclean condition, to remove their sin, and give them new life. Part of the problem, though, is this. Part of the problem is that we have with sharing the good news is that we're concerned that people will reject the good news.
That's right.
You know that's true. Have you ever been rejected whenever you try to talk to somebody about the Lord?
Yes.
Amen. I know that I have. I've been rejected on more than one occasion. Thank God that I've done it so many times. I've been rejected so many times. Now it doesn't really bother me too bad. But at first, it kind of hurts. I mean, maybe for a hardened salesman, it wouldn't be too bad. But people that didn't have to sell stuff for a living, you know, it makes it a little harder. But this little girl, she just did what she was called to do. She told the truth about the prophet Elisha. The hand of God was on him. God used him to perform miracles, and she knew that if she could get Naaman to him, then his skin would be clean. She didn't even have to tell it straight to him. She didn't have to go straight to the king. She didn't have to even go straight to Naaman. She just preached it loud enough and often enough that someone else heard it, and then they went and spread the word. Amen?
Amen.
But look, the reality is that there will be times, many times in our lives, when people will reject the gospel. And then some will hear the gospel and they'll take a step towards it only to hear a little bit more and then back away again. But that is not our responsibility. I need you to know that. Some of you sitting in this room today can attest to the fact that the first time somebody ever talked to you about the gospel, you probably thought they were crazy. The first time that they told you that Jesus had changed their life, you probably thought they were crazy, right? But at the same time, maybe that person didn't quit. Or maybe God sent somebody else to say it again. And more seeds were planted. And more things happening in your life to get your attention, to cause you to become more aware of the fact that, hey, maybe this story isn't so crazy. Naaman had some things going on in his life that made him hope. He wanted to have some hope that there was something better for his life. It's not our responsibility to make him believe. It's just our responsibility to tell the truth. At first, the closer that Naaman, well, you know, before I, you know, I'm just over here reading some of my notes, but let me just take a step away and say, you know, aren't you glad? I mean, if you're truly saved and the Holy Spirit has come to live on the inside of your heart and you've experienced resurrection life, aren't you glad that somebody was kind of like that little girl?
Yeah.
Amen. And didn't quit and kept on speaking the truth, whoever that person is. I'm sure all of our minds can flood back to the first time that we heard the good news of the gospel, the good news about new life. I don't know about you, but I'm glad. I'm glad my sister kept on telling me the truth. I'm glad that there was those people, even though they were a little strange in Lafayette, that took in orphans into their house. And I went to school with this kid. He could beat everybody up in the school, so I wanted to be his friend. But he lived with these people, and I went and visited him, and they loved Jesus. And all they ever talked about was Jesus. And all these little seeds that were being planted in my life, and everything was so different than everything else around me that other people were talking about. And I just thank God that people were willing to tell the truth.
That's right.
At first, the closer that Naaman got to the truth, he didn't like it. He couldn't believe it, and he wanted to move away from it. And that's not uncommon with the gospel. People don't understand how the death of a man 2,000 years ago can bring life today. But the more they hear it, the more the Holy Spirit works in their heart telling them that there's hope. There's hope to be released from the plague that they've been carrying around. They might not have known it was sin. They might not have been screaming it in the streets, right? But on the inside, they've been weighted down and their heart has been screaming, unclean, unclean. Isn't there any help? Isn't there any hope? Isn't there anything more than this? I don't know about you, but that was something that I oftentimes used to think in my head. My sister had already told me about the Lord, and there I was just living life day after day, trying to find some kind of happiness through the party, trying to find some kind of meaning in life, and kept questioning in my heart, surely there's something more than this. Yeah. And then God sent them a little maid, and that's you. Or it can be you, it can be me. And we tell them the truth. We tell them what they're willing to hear more, like Naaman was. But when he heard how illogical it was, he became mad. You remember that? 2 Kings chapter 5, verses 11 and 12. Whenever you showed up at the prophet's house, Naaman, the Bible says, was wroth. That's another word for he was full of wrath. He was full of anger. He went away and said, behold, I thought he would surely come out and stand and call on the name of the Lord his God and strike his hand over the place and he would just recover the leper. Are not Abana and Pharpar, rivers of Damascus, better than all the waters of Israel? May I not wash in them and be clean? So he turned and went away in a rage. The Jordan, like I said, he wants me to wash in the Jordan? There's cleaner rivers than that. There's better rivers than that. And that's the problem that we have in modern society. There's better ways to fix people than for them to believe in some Jewish man that died on two pieces of wood outside a city called Jerusalem 2,000 years ago. You know, that's the big word nowadays. How is this even relevant to me? How is this even relevant to my life today? They make little funny videos about Jesus. You put it on YouTube, and some lady showed me one time where, you know, they dub in a voice for Jesus, and they make him seem so silly. He's walking around in this little kind of fruity voice. Oh, you little sinner, and you're doing this bad. And they just look at him as though he's so irrelevant. But what they don't understand is that there's a big old God. Amen. He's got a big old plan. And while it may seem irrelevant and that it took take place 2,000 years ago, for 2,000 years when this message has been preached and somebody would be willing just to believe, not to try to believe with the mind and all of its intellect, which will get you in trouble half the time anyway, but instead to believe with the inner man, amen, that God put on the inside, something on the inside of you to give you the opportunity. It's called faith. He gave you a measure of faith, and if you are just willing to reach out and to believe just a little bit by faith, God will begin to reveal himself to you more clearly, more strongly as each and every day goes by. Amen. Hallelujah. And the gospel will begin to change your life.
Amen.
Now, I got to tell you that you know, many times we don't want to accept the gospel because we're scared. We don't want to let go. We don't want to let go of the old stuff. We don't want to let go of the life that we've always known. You know, and that's kind of like Naaman too. I know about Pharpar and the other river over there. They're real clean. They're pretty. I know about Syria. And I don't know about all this stuff in Israel. The unknown. People shrink back because they don't understand. They don't know. They're unwilling to take a step of faith. And so oftentimes people miss their miracle from God because in their mind it makes no sense. And if they can't control it, come on somebody, help me out here. I know some of y'all shaking y'all head. Yeah, I know what you mean, preacher. You know what I'm talking about. We like to control stuff. And if we can't control it, we feel like we're losing, well, we feel like we're losing control. and it's uncomfortable. We can't control it. We can't figure it out with our intellect. You know? Then we walk away. They walk away. They don't want it, and they walk away empty and still burdened and still unclean. But Naaman, ultimately, he went for it. He had friends that didn't give up on him. They kept encouraging him. What do you have to lose, Naaman? Give it a shot. There's a song that says, what a friend we have in Jesus. I thank God that, you know, that not only did I have family members, and I hope that I've been a friend to some people since Jesus, but Jesus was a friend.
Yes.
You know what I'm saying? Jesus didn't give up on me. Like Naaman's friends, Jesus didn't give up on me. Even though I ran, even though I ignored, even though sometimes I laughed, and turned my back, Jesus didn't give up on me. And there was a song, if I could sing, I'd sing it for you. It says, what a friend we have in Jesus, all our sins and griefs to bear, and what a privilege to carry everything to God in prayer. Oh, what peace we often forfeit. Oh, what needless pain we bear, all because we do not carry everything to God in prayer. I can tell you that Jesus is a friend that sticks closer than a brother. There's times in your life, I've shared this with you before, and I didn't make it up. I got it from the old preacher I used to listen to. He said there's going to be times when you're going to try to call the preacher and he's not going to answer the phone. There's going to be times when your mom is not there to talk to you. There's going to be times when your spouse won't be there, your kids won't be there, and you're going to feel like you're all alone. But I can tell you, you'll never be alone if you have a relationship with Jesus. Amen. Right. You can call on him. Praise God. You can call on him no matter what you're going through. You bear your heart to him and his presence will show up. Amen. We have a friend in Jesus because even though we didn't come right away, even though we might have ran away, he never gave up on us. He kept pursuing us and convincing us until one day, like Naaman, we took the plunge of faith and bam, we received new life. Look at this new skin. I can see him saying it. Now look at this new skin. It's like the skin of a child. The leprosy is gone. The weight of sin is gone. It's like a new life. Naaman went into that water with a plague and he came out again with the skin of a child. That is resurrection life in Jesus. The old man that we were dies through faith and a new man is resurrected to a new life. Forget the eggs and the chickens. Forget the rabbits and the green leaves. I have new life in Christ. And that's what this day is all about. The fact that God is offering new life. He's offering new life to whoever is willing to believe him for it. Amen? Now, I just wanted to share a couple of truths with you. I don't think that we'll be too long on this resurrection morning, but I wanted to share a couple of New Testament truths with you about the resurrection. If you go to John chapter 11, and we'll read verses 23 through 26. My first point I wanted to make is this, is that Jesus didn't just resurrect from the dead. He is the resurrection from the dead. Amen? In John chapter 11, verse 23 through 26, this passage of scripture is on the heels of Lazarus dying. Lazarus was a friend of Jesus. He had a sister named Martha and another sister named Mary. The Bible says that whenever Jesus heard that Lazarus was dead, he tarried still another 3 days, if I'm not mistaken, is what it was. In other words, he waited. And when he showed up, they were questioning him, why did you wait so long? Had you been here before? Because they had heard that Jesus had healed people. If he would have showed up a little bit sooner, you could have healed Lazarus and he wouldn't have died. But Jesus purposefully waited, amen, those days, because he wanted everybody to know that he had power over life and death. And in this conversation, he's talking to Martha, and he says to Martha, Jesus says unto her, your brother will rise again. Martha said unto him, I know that he shall rise again in the resurrection at the last day. Jesus said unto her, I am the resurrection and the life. He that believes in me, though he were dead, yet shall he live, and whosoever lives and believes in me shall never die. Do you believe this? Yes. Now, many times people want to believe in Jesus, or you know, you've heard people preach before, oh, they just want their get out of hell free card. But the truth be told is that what the Bible is offering is eternal life. That means that whenever the end of this life, in him is resurrection power, and that power will also raise us physically from the dead. He makes dead stuff live, and the end of this life is just the beginning of the next life. The Bible teaches the fact that there's no more pain, no more sorrow, amen. No more tears. Amen. 1 Corinthians, and we're talking about physical resurrection right now. The whole story of Naaman, to me, is a story of the resurrection power of God that changes us today, amen, and changes us on a continual basis until the day that we are raised from the dead, or until, like the Bible teaches, the rapture of the church takes place, which is really another word for resurrection. And when we see him, We become as he is. We receive a glorified body. The story of Naaman, though, is about spiritual resurrection. Spiritual resurrection, where we're resurrected from that sinful state that we received in our first birth of Adam, where we carried around, like Naaman carried around leprosy, this problem called sin. But the good news is that Jesus' death on the cross and our faith in that allows us to become one with him, where we die with him and resurrect to newness of life. But right now we're talking about physical resurrection. He is the resurrection and the life. 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verses 20 through 23 talks about physical resurrection. You know, as soon as Adam and Eve disobeyed God, death entered into them. It was a slow process. The Bible says that they lived for hundreds of years. You might have a problem with that. I believe it. I'm simple enough to just believe the Bible.
Amen.
They might try to cause some confusion in some biology students nowadays, but they ain't got Jesus living on the inside of their hearts either. And I'm here to tell you something else. Scientists purposefully want to muddy the water and cause confusion. It's not very hard to figure that out. All you got to do is Google quotes from atheist scientists who don't want to believe in God or something like that. I'm sure it's going to come up. I've seen the quotes before. They say we have to believe in evolution because the alternative is unthinkable. In other words, there's a real God in heaven that we're going to have to answer to one day. And the reality is that I believe that science is oftentimes trying to hide the truth about God, about the scriptures from us to begin with. It's not that confusing to think that. If God is real and the devil is real, then the devil wants to do everything that he can to prevent people from believing. Whether it be through education, whether it be through science, whatever it may be, whether it be in your personal life causing confusion and causing other people that call themselves Christians to treat you wrong, and so therefore you no longer believe in it, even though they weren't the ones that died for you, Jesus did. You get the point that I'm trying to make. The devil will stop at nothing to cause the human race to not believe in this message of resurrection life. But I'm here to tell you that there's going to be a day when every dead body is going to raise, and those who remain are alive and remain will go to meet him in the air. That's what the Bible says. Amen. 1 Corinthians 15, verses 20 through 23. But now is Christ risen from the dead and become the first fruits of them that slept. The first fruits were part of one of Israel's feasts, where they would go out into the field and they'd reach down there for the barley harvest and they'd grab a sheaf of wheat and they'd wave it. It was the first fruits. The first fruits of the harvest. What they're talking about, see, God is going to have a harvest one day. And he's going to have a harvest of humanity. And he's going to pull those that have made the choice on this side of eternity to live for him. And there's going to be a great reaping of a harvest of human souls. But Jesus was the first fruits. He was the first one to resurrect from the dead. The rest of the harvest is yet to come. But now is Christ risen from the dead and become the first fruits of them that slept. That's another terminology. Really, he's talking about those that died in Christ. In other words, died in the faith. For since by man came death, what I tell you, Adam brought death into the human race, by man came also the resurrection of the dead. For as in Adam all die, even so in Christ shall all be made alive. Yeah. But every man in his own order. Christ the first fruits, afterward they that are Christ at his coming. This is kind of like a perfect example of a scripture that explains many times what I've tried to explain to y'all about the humanity of Christ. Josh and I were having a little conversation after Wednesday night's message, and one of the main things that stuck out to him and what I had said was when I talked about the humanity of Christ, about the fact that we oftentimes think only of Jesus as God walking around on the earth. But the reality of it is that God can't die. God doesn't get sleepy. God never gets hungry. God never sinned. It wasn't required of God to die. Man sinned. Not just any kind of man, but the perfect man. Meaning, God created Adam in his image and likeness. There was no sin in Adam. But sin went the way of the liar and brought sin into himself. And through one man, all died. Through one man, all can receive the resurrection of life. Amen. And what that tells us is that that's bad news in some sense. Why? What you talking about? Because the Bible says, Romans 6:23, the wages of sin is death. You know, one of the things that I've thought about often is this, is that, what we first want to do when we first hear the gospel is blame Adam. Oh, Adam, you aggravate me, man. You went and sinned and you caused the untold misery for the entire human race. Well, hold on a second. I don't know if you played cards or not growing up. My family played cards, and one of the things that I learned as a young kid in Boo Rays, if you didn't throw the ante in the pot, then you wasn't in the game, and if you tried to play, then that was a problem. You got to ante up. I got to tell you that we've all put our ante into the pot. In other words, what does that mean? You've all sinned. Each and every one of us has gone the way of Adam. Even though we were originally born with it, we've also done our own share, is the point. We haven't done this thing unscathed. Each and every one of us in the eyes of God were guilty. So we got bad news. We got a problem because the wages of sin is death. But then I got good news. Because see, God became a man. Amen. God became a man who had no sin. Born of different seed, not the seed of Adam. And he offered that sinless life on the cross. Hallelujah. There was no wage for Jesus to pay. He paid your wage. You and I were the ones that had anteed up. You and I were the ones that were sinful. But Jesus took our sin upon him and he paid the penalty. You can keep walking around with it if you want. You can keep walking around in misery and moping around and sad and unhappy in life and not being able to figure out what it is that's going on and why it is that you always feel the way that you do. But possibly it's because you have not allowed the joy of the Lord to enter into your heart. Amen. Now, I will tell you this. Just because you give your life to Jesus, don't think that there won't be any sad days. Don't think that the clouds don't still get dark. Don't think that the rain never falls, because that just wouldn't be true. But ultimately, what I'm here to tell you is this, is that no matter what you're going through, he will stick close to you. And if you call upon him, amen, he will get you through. Praise God. Sometimes we just got to be like Naaman. I mean, we got to get to the point where we're like, why not? Why not just jump on into Jordan? Why not give it a shot? Even though we may not understand it, it may not make any sense. Why not give it a chance? Lord, if you're real, I dare you to do that. If you've never given your heart to Jesus, I dare you to say, Lord, if you're real, please just show me the truth. Lord, if you're real, show me the truth. Now listen, that's a dangerous prayer to pray. And what I mean by that is you better be meaning that you really want the truth. Because God's not going to be the, for lack of better words, the butt of any joke. And he knows the heart of man. And the enemy will bring you like some kind of little counterfeit and try to convince you of the truth, and it wasn't the truth. If you're going to pray that prayer, you need to really be looking for the truth.
That's right.
But if you're really looking for the truth, and you pray that prayer, God, show me the truth. He's going to show you. He's going to lead and guide you to the truth. So now we don't, thank God, we don't have a problem, because Jesus paid the penalty. He paid the wages of sin. But for this resurrection from the physical dead, you have to be patient. That's point number one. He didn't just resurrect from the dead, but he is the resurrection from the dead.
Yeah,
I'm here to tell you, though, for this physical resurrection, you're going to have to be patient. You're going to have to be patient either, number one, till you die and the resurrection takes place, the rapture happens, or until we're still alive and the rapture happens. Until then, we won't receive our glorified body. But I got to tell you that I have good news, because there's a resurrection for us today. It's one kind of like the one that Naaman experienced. There's a resurrection for us today, and we don't have to wait until we die or until the rapture. God offers new life today. Amen? Jesus offers a new resurrection life today. If you could go to Romans chapter 6, verse 5. Actually, why don't you go ahead and go to verse 1. And we'll just read the whole thing. It says, what shall we say then? Shall we continue in sin so that grace may abound? Go to the next. God forbid. How shall we that are dead to sin live any longer therein? Know ye not that so many of us as were baptized into Jesus Christ were baptized into his death? Therefore we are buried with him by baptism into death, that like as Christ was raised up from the dead by the glory of the Father, even so we also should walk in newness of life. Verse 5. For if we have been planted together in the likeness of his death, we shall be also in the likeness of his resurrection. This scripture, this passage of scripture is not talking about the physical resurrection. This passage of scripture is actually talking about something that we've already mentioned several times this morning, because the gospel is full of it. That the first birth in Adam, we were born in sin. But that when we put our faith in Christ, a miracle took place. If you've ever truly given your heart to the Lord, you know what I'm talking about. Because when you've truly been born again, a spiritual miracle takes place on the inside of your heart. The burden of sin is removed. The old man that was born of Adam becomes one with Jesus in the mind of God, and that old man dies and he's buried in the grave, and a new man is resurrected with Jesus and he receives new life. Whenever you give your heart to the Lord and the Holy Spirit comes to live on the inside of you, I promise you, you will never be the same. You may try to run and reject, but if you do, it'll be worse than what it was for you the first time. But if you'll continue to walk with Him and live with Him, you will begin to experience that resurrection life. The gospel teaches that we don't only die with Him through faith, but that we experience new life. New resurrection life. A new life where the old man born of Adam dies and a new man receives the life of Jesus. Amen? Amen. Romans chapter 8 verse 11 says if the spirit of him that raised up Jesus from the dead dwells in you, he that raised up Christ from the dead shall also quicken your mortal bodies by his spirit that dwells in you. A lot of times people believe this is again talking about the physical resurrection. That's not what it's talking about. It's talking about the fact that you who were previously dead in your sin, if you will keep faith in Christ, if you will put faith in Christ, the same Spirit that raised Jesus' lifeless body from the dead will now quicken or bring life to your mortal body and give you life and give you hope, amen, and give you strength in order to live for God on this earth today. The same Spirit that raised him up from the tomb on that Sunday morning is the same Spirit that entered your heart on the day when you listened to the little maid and you jumped in the river. In other words, you heard the gospel and you believed. This Holy Spirit that raised Jesus up moved into your heart and rose you up from the dead. I'm going to close with this one. I had one more after this, but I think I'm going to just close with number three. The better we know him, the more we can experience this resurrection life. Go to Philippians chapter 3 for me. Starting in verse 9. This is the Apostle Paul. He's in prison. He's writing a letter to a church in Asia Minor. It's called the Church to the Philippians, a city called Philippi. He says, why don't you go up to verse 8. He's talking about all of the things that he used to have before Jesus. And he says, yes, doubtless, and I count all things but loss for the excellency of the knowledge of Christ Jesus my Lord. Now, the Apostle Paul was on a fast track to being a major religious leader. He was a Jewish man. He was, many times people would consider also people have given up their careers. They've given up their occupations in order to serve the Lord, to go into the ministry, to preach. And the Apostle Paul is basically saying, everything that I had before, I consider it dung. What is that? It's like a pile of poop. He says, in order, for the knowledge of knowing Jesus, for whom I have suffered the loss of all things and do count them but dung, that I may win Christ and be found in him, not having my own righteousness. See, that's something that happens when you put faith in Christ and what he did for you at the cross. There's an exchange that takes place. Because he offered his righteousness up as payment or the wage of death for your sin, and he took your sin upon him. Now, whenever you put faith in that, God allows an exchange to take place. He allows your sin to be paid for on Jesus. He allows Jesus' righteousness to be given to you as a gift. And now, Paul says, I want to be found in him. I want, when the Father sees me, to see me in Jesus.
Right.
I want Jesus' righteousness to be my cover. I don't want to stand on my own. I want to stand in Christ. which is a, he says, and be found in him, not having my own righteousness, which is of the law. You can try to go through a bunch of rules and regulations and try to accomplish a whole lot of things. You can try to powder puff yourself on the outside, make yourself look nice and pretty. And that's what, I hate to say it, but that's what psychology tries to do to humanity. Trying to fix all everybody up on the outside, trying to put band-aids on them, give them a little bit of medicine to calm all the problems. I'm not picking on you if you take medicine. That's not what I'm doing. I'm trying to make a point. That the reason people have to take medicine is because of past hurts internally that have never been dealt with. The Holy Spirit wants to reach on the inside of our hearts, and he wants to bring healing through the power of the Holy Spirit, and he wants to make us whole on the inside. Amen?
Amen.
You can't clean stuff up on the outside. That's not the same thing as what the gospel does. The gospel changes stuff on the inside.
Yes.
But this is what Paul says. He says, through the faith of Christ, the righteousness which is of God by faith, that I may know him and the power of his resurrection and the fellowship of his sufferings, being made conformable unto his death. He said, if I may know him and the power of his resurrection. When he's talking about the fellowship of his sufferings, he's not talking about I need to suffer some more because Jesus didn't suffer enough for man's sins. That's not what he's talking about. What he's talking about is the fact that Jesus already died for the sins of humanity. But just as Jesus was rejected, people that live for the Lord today are going to also at times experience persecution. I doubt any of us will ever experience what the Apostle Paul experienced. But nevertheless, many times there's persecution that's there because of our choice to live for the Lord. But one of the things that he said, and that's really what I want to close with, is this, is that the more we get to know him, the more we get to know this Jesus that loved us and died for us, the more we're able to experience his resurrection power in our daily lives today. Amen? I got good news. He's alive. He's living in the hearts of his people. One day he's coming back for his people. And there's going to be a physical resurrection. Amen? But until then, I'm here to tell you, there's a spiritual resurrection. One where he'll make you new. Where he don't just clean up. The outside gets cleaned up. But it's because he does a work on the inside.